Hello, everyone, and welcome back to a new episode of our podcast, European Stories from a Union of Volunteers. The guest from this week's episode comes from North Macedonia and has been volunteering since he was 14 years old. At age 19, he did the ESC project in the northernmost village of Iceland, Torshop, for 3 months and then for another 3 months in Reykjavik. Now he's doing volunteer work with the UN and is also a member of the European Solidarity Network. Dario Corolia, thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much for the awesome introduction, Jose. I hope you're doing good in this, unusual times and that you're safe.
Thank you. I'm doing very well. So you've been volunteering since you were 14 years old. How did you start volunteering and how did you come across the EVS or the ESC opportunity?
Thanks for the question. I started firstly going in a local rallies in my town with one local NGO promoting the Europe Day and the International Day of Human Rights and other, international celebrations. And then I started going to some workshops for intercultural communication. And then I got the opportunity to go on a youth exchange in Switzerland, which changed my life. And that's where I went deeply into intercultural communication, but also key issues such as migration and LGBT and other challenges that this world has. So when I came back after 2 weeks in Switzerland, I said to myself, this is what I want to do, and this is what I want to focus in my life, to be a world citizen and to do my fair share and make the world a better place.
So you went to Switzerland for this exchange or what was it exactly?
I went to a youth exchange with 160 people from North Macedonia, Serbia, Ukraine, and Moldova. And that was in the Pestalozzi Children's Foundation, which was not connected with European programs or European funding. But it was a great way of, opening the world for me. And that was the first experience that I traveled on my own alone.
But then how did you find out about the ESC project or opportunity?
Yeah, I started my small steps in a local NGO in my town called Center for Intercultural Dialogue. And they had a youth center called Multiculti. And they were international volunteers, EVS. Mm-hmm. And I met some of them and I learned their stories and they inspired me. And I learned about the rules. And when I heard about it, and I got really, inspired and just waited for my time to come and make the most of it and make the most unusual EVS ever that I can do.
But okay, so they told you about this possibility, but then how did you choose to go to Iceland specifically? How did you choose your project, or was it influenced by where it was, or was it just because of the project that you applied for that interested you the most and not exactly the place?
Yeah, so Iceland was not in the main plan. I was really excited for one project in Malaga in Spain that I had the chance to visit before in the same organization that I was interested to. And it was a public relations position for 12 months. And I applied and I was really hoping that I will get that. And because I already knew the organization and I demonstrated my skills well, and I was in the first top five, but then in the end I was not chosen and I didn't get that position, but I wasn't disappointed at all. And what I decided to do as a next step, so this was just before I graduated from high school, I wanted to do, as I mentioned before, EVS in an unusual way. So what I did is I created a database of youth organizations in entire Europe.
Wow.
Around 100 of them in many countries in topics that interested me. And I just emailed many of them. And what I got is only compliments and this kind of stuff, but nothing other than those things. And then the primary school of Torshop replied only. with you know, with the interest of interviewing me. So when I read the description that I'll be potentially be a teaching assistant in the most isolated village in Iceland, a fishing village, I said, okay, yes, this is what is definitely that I would like to do, because it sounds like a fairy tale. And as it sounded, you know, it transcended my expectations. And yeah, it was the most, you know, valuable experience in my life, probably.
Okay. I mean, your process of application and like how detailed in you were in like choosing the project or the associations, it's like nothing. I've never heard of someone doing anything similar to that.
Thanks.
It shows your ambition and your willingness to do that, which is great.
Appreciate it.
And then you were ready to leave, right? To Torshov.
Yeah.
Now that you have arrived, what was the first, or when you arrived, what was the first thought or impression, either in Iceland, or let's divide this in two steps, when you arrived in Iceland and then when you arrived in this fishing village in the middle of nowhere?
Okay. Well, the thing is that it sounds very cool. You said you made it to Iceland. Well, it was not that easy, even though I got accepted before I answered your question. I had to wait for an entire year and to prepare documentation for immigration policies and processes. So it was like a extensive process, and I was supposed to start in December, then in January, and then I started in the end in March because of complications. But as you said, I made it, and when I arrived and I stepped out of the plane, I just felt the magic. There is something in that Icelandic air, and I will never forget that moment. There is some sort of chilliness and something that I never experienced before. I'm privileged to have traveled, you know, in many European countries. Mm-hmm. And you know, I noticed that the more Western the country in Europe is, the more I like it. But Iceland is just, it was just, you know, mind-blowing. Uh-huh. So when that was the first impression when I stepped out of the plane. And then when I arrived in Reykjavik, actually, for 1 week, I was there to do my medical examination because I had to do things with a residence permit. And for that week, it was very cool. And I was in a very cool group of volunteers that actually became my housemates later when I went to Reykjavik. But I will get back later about this. Mm-hmm. So after 1 week, the thing is that I was supposed to go to the village with 3 flights from Reykjavik to the village, because that's how the connection works.
Okay.
And there are no flights every day. So I had to fly Reykjavik Akureyri, in the second biggest thing, town in Iceland, which is like not big at all. And from Akureyri, I had to fly to Vopnafjörður. And from Vopnafjörður, I had to fly probably to Torshov, I think. I think that there is no other stop. But later on, that idea, for some reason, the organization decided to not take. And because I was, probably one of the first people that went to the village, and they wanted to make sure that I'm going in the right place, in the right hands. Mm-hmm. Of course, they did APV before, but you know, they just wanted to drive me. So
they went to pick you.
They picked me up from Reykjavik. My hosting, actually the coordinating organization, because I had a different coordinating and hosting organization. Mm-hmm. So the coordinating organization drove me from Reykjavik to Torshov. It is about at least 400 kilometers in one way. So it was amazing journey.
I can imagine.
Maybe I'm going to so deep in this answer, but
no, go ahead.
Iceland is so magical that the climate is very different in every, you know, 50 meters. So while traveling, I saw snow and sun and rain, and you know, it's just, you drive on a clear road. It looks, you know, it's green, and everything is, you know, how to say, clear. And you know, 30 seconds later, you see a storm of snow and everything is like blowing away. And it was so cool. It was an entire day trip. And then I, by traveling on the road, I saw the sunset as well, which was very magical. And then finally, I made it to Torsó. Mm-hmm. So it was the first expectation is, impression was, oh, this is not so isolated as I thought it will be. Because I thought it was like, I don't know, I don't want to use a not nice word, but I thought it was like a very bad conditions because I was ready to, you know, I wanted to challenge myself and live in bad conditions. But there were, it was probably more advanced and more developed than my town in Macedonia, which is the third biggest. Even though the, I have to say, the village is with only 300 people, it has three streets. But still, it has a supermarket, mm-hmm. it has a restaurant, it has a bank, all the things you need in life, and that's it. So I stepped out of the car, and I didn't have the chance to see the Northern Lights before, and at that period, the Northern Lights, like, that period was not was kind of now. How to say, the Northern Lights already passed. It was, they were supposed to pass and they were not supposed to be there. They're usually, you can see them, outside of the town where there is not so much of light pollution and air pollution. But at that time when I arrived, the host informed me that, at the very that moment, the Northern Lights appear and the entire sky was green and
what?
It was so impressive. And I was just staring at the sky and just looking. And
that is the perfect welcome anyone could receive.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So yeah, that's you know, the long answer to your question.
Oh, that's good. Your first impression was a very long impression because you took a long time to arrive at the village. So it's fine. Don't worry.
Yeah.
And once you arrived there, where did you live? You said that the conditions weren't as bad as you were expecting, but how was the house or the apartment and who did you live with?
Yeah. So I lived with a host family. Mm-hmm. And actually that house was, on the first floor was the municipality and the second floor was the house.
Okay.
And the house was very amazing. It's just like a proper family house. And I had my own room and we actually, I was not alone in Torsó. There was another volunteer from Slovenia. Mm-hmm. And so we had our separate rooms and it was very comfy. The bed was amazing. And I had a view in the river or in the pond, whatever it is. And yeah, it was very cool.
Okay. So now in this village that not a lot of people live there, what did you work or why did you go there? What was the work as a volunteer that you had to do there?
Yeah. So I volunteered with children with and without disabilities. Mm-hmm. There were about 77, all of them. So I mainly assisted in English classes, in mathematics, in art, and some extracurricular activities in a youth center and playing with them during breaks. And yeah, it was just very, very amazing. It not boring at all, even though, you know, it's a small village and the school hours are not that long. So I had a bunch of free time to reflect about myself and to think about life and just to enjoy myself and to go away from people. And yeah, it was very cool.
And in this work that you did with the children, what was the thing that you liked the most?
The ability to influence them and to be a role model. This is actually what I was not aware that I possess. Mm-hmm. And I realized that they, I mean, this is what I heard from the teachers and from parents, that they admire me and that they like me so much. And I mean, in a way, Now to me, it's obvious because 3 days after we met, we were in the kitchen and eating together, and a bunch of group of children came to me and started hugging me, and they asked me, "Can you be our brother?" And I said, "Yeah, for sure, I can be your brother. I can be your friend. I'm your everything, and yeah, you can talk with me always, and we can play together." And we had an amazing 3 months together.
Oh, that's great. I mean, I also volunteered, not entirely, but some parts of my volunteering were with kids. And there's every time I left the school with the kids, you felt your heart, like all your body just warmer. It's so, so nice to be with kids.
Right.
And you also did the other 3 months in Reykjavik after this. What happened and what was your work in Reykjavik? Was also with children? What was it?
Yeah, the thing is that, as I said, I arrived a bit later in March that it was initially planned. So it came out that the school year is, I won't be able to work for the entire school year. So yeah. I had like sort of 3 months that I will have to do something.
Yeah.
And it came out that I'll have to move to Reykjavik and to do a very, very different placement, which was working with elderly people in a supportive center for people that have various different mental conditions.
Mm-hmm.
So it was very different. The average group, the average age of the group was around 70 years. And it was challenging, of course, to some extent, but also it awakened me that I can work in a very different conditions, and that I'm able to handle whatever I want to. So yeah, it was very interesting.
Okay, and you mentioned there were some challenges. What was one of the things that were challenging, either with the elderly people or with the kids, or both, if you would like to, if you have one challenge for each of them? What was one of these challenges that you had to overcome, and what did you learn?
The most challenging thing was that I was kind of surprised, not say shocked, that I will have to do like a different service with this huge age gap. So it was sort of challenging to adapt, but I gave my best and I did adapt it, and it worked well in the end. So this is what I would like, point out.
Now, let's say that you're at dinner with some friends and they ask you about your volunteering project and you want to tell them one of the craziest stories that you experienced during these 6 months. What would that be?
This is a big question because Iceland was very adventurous, and I had many, many memorable moments. But if I have really to choose, I would say is when I saw death in front of my eyes.
What?
So, there is a mountain in Reykjavik called Esjan, and I'm not an experienced mountain climber at all, but I just decided to go, and it's not challenging. I mean, there are different paths that are recommended for various groups, depends on your skills. So I did research and made it to the Stetl, which means the stone. And it's very easy to go there and hike. But the general recommendations were to not go beyond Stetl because it's only for advanced hikers. And on my way going up to the stone, I met with people from around the world, and then some of them stayed, some of them left. And when you make to the stone, there is a book that you sign. So while signing, a couple of from the United States approached, and we started talking something, and they were saying that they're just going up to the top, and they will just go.
Yeah.
And while we were having this conversation, in the same time, a young woman in a short pants, in a running shoes, in a short t-shirt, with a very light bag. It's like jumping from, you know, I don't know how to explain, but going with such a ease from up to down, from the top to the stone.
Okay.
And she was like, hey, this is so cool. I mean, I made it to the top. It was very easy. And, you know, she didn't have any kind of equipment on her that said, okay, this will be challenging. And this kind of shift my mind. And
he decided to go.
And yeah, I was like thinking, should I go or should I not go? And the Americans pursued me and they said, you will go with us. We are going together. And
oh my God.
We started climbing. But I think we sort of missed the trail. So as you go up, the more you go up, the more it's steep. And the soil is very dry. So it's like a desert.
Mm-hmm.
And there is nothing that you can hold on. So as you go up, you can go up, but going down is very, very difficult.
Slippery, yeah.
And we made to the certain point of the top, and then I started sleeping like very, very hard. And if I trust you watched The Lion King, and you remember the scene when Scar is pulling down Mufasa.
Yes.
This is actually how I felt. because I was like a very, like Iceland has amazing
landscapes,
but also rescue services.
Okay.
So it took me like a half of millisecond that I didn't call the rescue services and call a helicopter to rescue me, because I was just like sleeping and I couldn't go up and neither could go down.
Well, you could just go down, but not in the right way.
Yeah, and I was very lucky that actually that day there was a lot of fog. So I made it to the top, but I couldn't see Reykjavik. So I just saw clouds. And I think that helped me to handle like mentally.
Mm-hmm.
Because if I saw the view, it could probably more scared me. And yeah, it was foggy. And then Andrew, I think it was the name of the guy. And he said, I will help you. We'll go down together. Nothing to worry about. So how we went down is he slipped on his butt.
Mm-hmm.
So he sat and he was just, you know, slipping down.
Yeah.
But still there are like stones and different kind of obstacles that could hurt you by going down. And he helped me and I was just, you know, like sleeping slowly, 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 slowly. And I made safely. Yeah.
Oh, shit. That was intense. But the funny thing is that we interviewed another volunteer, and she also volunteered in Iceland, and her crazy story was also related to hiking.
Oh, really?
So maybe it is a common theme for the country.
Yeah.
So we're almost reaching the end of the episode now. Are you ready to check out?
Let's do it.
This part, we have just four questions. So first one, how would you describe your volunteering project in just one word?
Enriching.
Enriching. With what specifically?
Just you want the word or a sentence?
Okay, develop on the word maybe, because I would like to know how it was enriching, in what perspective.
Well, it enriched my cultural perspectives, tolerance levels. Very enriching. I mean, I'm not able at the moment to go deeply, but because it's so broad, there were so many experiences. And but I can say that I'm very, very, very grateful to the universe and the destiny and for whatever it was, you know, made me there to Iceland. So I am very grateful for the experience, but also to the commission and to the organizations for supporting me.
Yeah, that's great. Second, what is one thing that you miss from volunteering?
It could sound cliche, but it's life changing, and it's the both ways. You help change someone else's life, but you change yours at the same time. I think that This is the narrative that is circulating very often, but yeah, I just agree with it.
Okay, so you miss like being able to change your own life and change other people's lives.
Definitely. I just really hope that I will have the opportunity to serve someone else again in the near future. And mm-hmm. doesn't necessarily have to be with the European Solidarity Corps, but maybe with some other European program.
Mm-hmm. Third, what does solidarity mean to you?
I would say caring about the others and being kind and being thoughtful and putting ourselves in other people's shoes. Also a cliche, but you know, just be thoughtful and be kind to each other. And if we cannot be kind to each other, just let's try not to be mean.
Yeah, that's good. Last question. What song represents your volunteering experience?
So before I visit a new country, I'm very interested into culture and music and language. So I usually explore each of them. So I was exploring some popular bands in Iceland and I came across Retro Stefson. And their song Glow is the song that that I was listening through the entire year of going through the bureaucracy processes and just waiting to go to Iceland and getting postponed messages that it will happen. So I was listening to Retro Stefson all the time. And the day that was my flight that morning, I wake up and I play the video of Retro Stefson and like I put the speakers at home to 100%. I said, I'm coming Iceland, and it just made me tear up a bit. And yeah, this is the song that you know will mark my volunteer experience.
Oh, that's very nice. And it's also just to before we conclude, it's also very interesting that you mentioned the bureaucracy, because for most people that volunteer within the EU, they don't have those problems. But you not being part of the EU, because you're from North Macedonia, and also Iceland is not part of the EU, so like you have the bureaucracy always still exists. But I guess the important message here is that you were patient enough and stick through it, and you managed to go and to volunteer in the project that you wanted in the end.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. And I think you couldn't have said it better. But also I would say, don't take it for granted your rights for freedom of movement in Europe. I think it's actually something that is amazing. So yeah.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. This is the end of the episode. So if you want to listen to Dario's song, you can check it out on our playlist. We will leave the link in the show notes. And join us on the next week with a new guest and with our other host, Paula. So, bye-bye.
Bye-bye, Jose. Thank you so much for hosting me and for making the time from your tight agenda.
Bye.
Bye-bye.